Good morning, everyone. On behalf of the management, the Vice Chancellor, the Pro Chancellors, the Deans, and the heads of the School of Law, the School of Engineering, management, all the faculty members, the students, and the staff of the North Cap University, it gives me immense pleasure to welcome Honorable Justice Gyan Sudha Mishra, former judge of the Supreme Court of India and former Chief Justice of the Jharkhand High Court, to today's special seminar, which is part of the North Cap Masterclass series organized by the North Cap University Gurugram. Justice Mishra is indeed a highly acclaimed person, both at the national and international level. Ma'am, it is really an honor and privilege to have you amongst us today. First and foremost, I would like to introduce Justice Mishra to all of you. Justice Mishra received her legal education in Patna and enrolled as an advocate with the Bihar State Bar Council in the year 1972, at a time when it was very uncommon for women to join the legal profession. Justice Mishra worked very hard as a lawyer and engaged herself in several activities associated with the Bar Association. In Delhi, she practiced in the Supreme Court and also was elected as a treasurer, joint secretary, and member of the executive committee of the Supreme Court Bar Association several times. In recognition of her services and standing as a lawyer for more than 21 years, Justice Mishra was appointed as a judge of the Patna High Court in 1994. Soon thereafter, she was transferred to the Rajasthan High Court due to a transfer policy prevalent at that time. As the judge of the Rajasthan High Court, she decided many important matters relating to company law, arbitration law, and constitutional law. During her tenure as a judge with the Rajasthan High Court, she was also appointed as the chairman of the advisory board constituted under the National Security Act. In addition, she was also appointed as executive chairman of the Rajasthan Legal Services Authority. Here, she played a very active role and saw that legal aid and legal assistance was given to the vulnerable sections of the society. Justice Mishra has indeed been a very sensitive and a very humane judge. She's dealt with matters like stopping the incidence of child marriage, female feticide, and preventing other atrocities on women and children. After having completed 14 years as a judge in High Court, Justice Mishra was elevated as the Chief Justice of the Jharkhand High Court in the year 2008 and on 13th of July. She continued to be so till 29th April 2010. And on 30th April 2010, she was appointed as a judge of the Supreme Court of India. She was a very, very dynamic judge in the Supreme Court of India. She passed several landmark and noteworthy judgments. Some of them I'll mention over here. One was the Sri BCCI judgment. The other was the Aruna Schoenberg matter, where the concept of euthanasia was discussed in detail and a distinction was drawn between passive and active euthanasia. She also listened to the Ubhar fire tragedy case, and a dissenting opinion is appreciated even today. She felt that the management was liable for the huge loss of lives and whatever, you know, repercussions it had brought. And she directed that they should be paid a huge sum so that a trauma could be created. She is a firm believer in social justice. Apart from being a very powerful judge in the Supreme Court of India, she's participated extensively in international conferences on women and children relating to matters like violence, etc. Ma'am, thank you so much for being with us here today, despite your busy schedule. In a short while, Justice Mishra will be speaking on the topic, role of law in a democracy. The topic of today's lecture is very vibrant and much can be said and discussed under it. Democracy focuses on how societies select those who hold power, while the role of law is concerned with how political power is exercised. The ancient Greek philosopher Aristotle had said once, law should govern. Thus, governing through law is a critical factor for the advancement of democracy, rooted in equal rights and accountability. Having done political science at the master's level, coupled with her expertise in law, Justice Mishra, I'm sure, would add a lot of vigor and vitality to her talk on the role of law in a democracy. Ma'am, I request you to deliver your lecture now. Thank you so much. Over to you, ma'am.
Yeah. Hello, everyone. First of all, at the outset, I acknowledge that I'm truly delighted to be a part of the event where I would be interacting, although not physically, but visually and through the audio system, with the upcoming legal fraternity, rather I would say future legal fraternity, coming out from a place like Gurugram, which is, I would say, it's a rose in the region, which motivated the citizenry at large, how we can explore and expand. Setting up of this NorthCap University with, I guess I can, if I can use this expression, collaboration of Arizona State University, I'm quite sure the students would be exposed and introduced to the world at large. And, you know, based in Gurugram, they can be, have the experience and the learning skills, which is, you know, which they could have had by traveling abroad and getting it. Having said that, I'm also really thankful to Professor Batra, who with her persuasive, affectionate skills could, you know, arrange the date for my accommodation in this lecture program. And I'm really thankful for her for doing so many changes about the time and about the date, and also the management for this. That reflects that if they want to do it, they are also flexible. And why I'm saying this, there's it has a link with the legal mind also. And I want to share it that, you know, if your mind is flexible and accommodates to the situation, you can accommodate in life as well and get the result without compromising with what you want to do. You know, having a guest or not having a guest is a very small little issue, but you know, it's a mindset, because that is how, you know, that balance the scale of justice, which is the symbol of justice, that is there, where the judges have to keep weighing as to how to deliver justice and how to not be egoistical about their views and accept or change their mind and be firm also, even till the last minute. Because all of you are budding lawyers, because you are into law study. So I'm saying this because you might remember that someone has said like this. So I also like to compliment for suggesting so many, you know, subjects for my choice to address you. And I thought, since I have a background of political science and law, I think this is, the relevance of this topic and the subject that has been chosen today, that is role of law and democracy, the connection between democracy and the subject of law is so interconnected and so integral to each other that, in simplest of terms, if I have to say, the democracy is a form of government which is a principle as to how a country would be governed. As you are all aware, the most ancient governance in most of the countries initially had been kingship, even from the ages when we say Ram Rajya and Treta Yug, Dwapar Yug, etc. They are the governments was generally with the kingship. It was only when there was evolution in society and the awareness came into the minds of that through our education and through our experience around, all men and women are equal in the eye of law, and therefore there is no reason why the citizens at large should be the subjects for all time to come, subjects in the sense that a king is ruling, queen is ruling, and the others are just obeying them. So awareness seeped into the minds of the citizens at large and our leaders who had the vision that we must adopt democracy as a form of government. And as you are aware, I would not go deep into detail about democracy. What exactly is the democracy?
You may have some water.
I have to call my staff somewhere here.
Oh, okay.
It doesn't matter. I'll try to manage. So, democracy, as you are all aware, that it's the most popular definition or the adage, I would say, by Abraham Lincoln, democracy by the people, of the people, and for the people. Maybe three are, I'm jumbling up, whatever, but all the three, democracy by the people, for the people, and of the people, which means if you are adopting a democratic form of government, the people's will people's will over the system ought to prevail. And that is how so many countries adopted democratic form of government. And India, gaining freedom, our constitution framers also adopted the system of government, where we have not used the word democracy, but in the constitution, when the preamble says, we the people of India, that democratic spirit is engulfed and encapsulated into the governance, form of governance. Now, democracy, as I would say, this norm, democracy is a principle, is a theoretical aspect of governance, that this is the way that we want to govern. Now, why do I say there is a deep connection in between the democracy and law? Because after all, when you adopt a theory, And when you have to put it into practice, you have to adopt a procedure. How to ensure that the people's will prevails in a governance, and how the country at large would be able to manage the democratic process. And in that sense, straight away, we have to jump into the arena of law. Law, first of all, emanates from constitution. The constitution gives you a structure. What are your rights? What are your duties? They are to speak on, you know, duties was not so prevalent at that time. I'll come to that later. So the rights, duties, basically was ingrained into the constitution, a chapter. And after this constitutional framework, there were other laws. And the first and most important law to execute, I would use the expression, execute an implementation of the democratic norms, the Representation of People Act was enacted. And plethora of acts and regulations came into existence, and that was to give effect to the democratic process. So first of all is the constitution, which gives you an entire framework as to what are your rights. There shall be no discrimination on the basis of caste, sex, religion. There you will have the right, you will have the freedom of speech, your fundamental rights freedom of speech and expression, freedom to form assembly, freedom right to property, of course, it's not there. So if you go through the chapter on fundamental rights, reading it out to you, I'm just giving you the outline that these were the rights that were given out, that was to be given to the citizens. Then, of course, later on in 1976 amendment, the fundamental duties, first of all, were added to the constitution, where the duties of the citizens also have been given out, that what are the duties that they are required to discharge. Because generally we are obsessed with our rights, but don't forget that if there is a fundamental right to you, it is also the fundamental duty to discharge your obligation towards the state. Of course, I have always been emphasizing that duties. The other day, in a web series, this question came up. So the fundamental duties, I have always been emphasizing that the citizens have the fundamental duties, but there is a duty also for the state and the country at large to ensure that there is no abuse of the authority that is vested. And that is, as a judge, I have always, I have felt that, we tell people to follow the law, to abide by the legal process, but it is also enjoined upon the authority and the whosoever is exercising authority to ensure that you don't abuse the process. And in terms of the university, also like educational institution, also I said that when you preach the student, because that was in the context where some of the students were denied a seat in, that was before CLAT. So they were denied seat in spite of higher marks and all. So I had to, give them a peace of mind that you teach the students to not to use unfair means. But if you start with the use of unfair admissions, I don't think that your preaching would have much. Professor, please tell me, please tell me if I cross the time limit. Let me know when do at what time I have to stop.
Yeah, because... sure, ma'am. ma'am, we make you speak a little more, and then we can ask question and answers.
Okay.
Yeah, because so, the students are looking forward. You know, they all want to hear you.
Okay, then I'll try to move fast on the subject.
Yes.
So, so the constitutional framework and the representation of people and all the laws that came into existence, those are the norms and the precepts which has to be executed. How the democratic forms norms are to be executed, that is itself an indication how deep is the connection in between the law and the in between the law and the democratic norms. So first of all, Representation of People Act, where the people's will prevail in choosing the representative, and that is how so much of focus is there on free and fair election. If there is free and fair election, every individual will ensure that his or her will has taken a shape in the form of democratic process. But of course, these democratic execution of democratic norms are through our representative. Of course, all of us don't sit in the parliament, but our representative are there to take care. All of us don't sit in the legislature, but the member of legislative assembly and the council, they take care. So this is how the will of the people gets into the democratic process. And the next step is, how do that democratic process get connected with the law? Because it is the law courts, not merely the law courts, like, you know, if the chief election commissioner is there, first of all, to ensure that free and fair election should take place. And of course, the responsibility lies on the authorities also to ensure that law is executed in the purest of form. And when that purity, is gets, you know, if it is, you know, any aberration is entered, any in the execution part, if the if it is not done in a proper way, then of course the law courts are there and you get a remedy in the law court. If there is a discrimination, you can go to the law court. If you are you're denied your right, constitutional rights, your legal rights, constitutional rights as given out in the constitution, various acts. Because of the time limit, I can't go deep into detail. And you know, you have a broad idea of what exactly is the connection. Because don't think that democratic process, democracy is just a compartment and just an abstract idea. Yes, it is an abstract to some extent in the sense that we have adopted a mode of government focusing there shall be no discrimination. Each individual will have a right in the governance of the country. And that is executed through legal precepts, legal acts, the various acts, and also the procedural aspects. And if there are any aberration and if there are like execution is gets polluted in some way, then you get a remedy in a court of law. So the connection in between the law and democratic process is an ongoing experience, because there was a time when, you know, when land reforms came into existence. Land reforms, the large chunk of land were lying with the zamindars. Then came the zamindari abolition. That also was why it came, because land was considered to be a property to which, you know, which could not be concentrated in the hands of some individuals like zamindars, and everybody had a right in some way or the other. So reformatory measures also are coming through the law. So this subject of, you know, connection between law and the democracy, it's a very important subject of great relevance and value. And that's why I think it's a very beautiful subject that you have chosen, Professor Batra, and given me the choice to speak on this subject. And one can explore this topic, I think we'll have many more sessions to do that. But I have given you just an outline idea of what exactly is required to understand when we discuss democracy and law. In nutshell, if I have to give it in a capsule form, I would say democracy is your right and law is your right to see that democracy is executed in letter and spirit. Yes, execution is not a word which would be used in this sense. Execution is that when you get a court decree, then you go to the court and get your rights executed. But when you understand this, so you have to feel confident that yes, we are living in, and you will be the judges, judge of the judges, that whether these democratic norms are being followed truly or not. And if not, then you have to stand up with to even to protest, but with a duty and obligation that you cannot cross the line. And I have always said, on many forums I've said, judge is not merely the one who has been designated as a judge. There is a judge in each one's conscience, and that judge will tell you what is right and wrong. So when you have the democratic rights, you have also the obligation to ensure that you have to see that you give opportunity to the masters in the sense that they are taking care of your rights. Side by side, the masters also have an obligation to ensure that the process of governance is not abused. I would not, because I can see Professor Batra, I'm conscious, maybe you're looking at the clock or what, I don't know, but I quite respect your the time limit, and especially in a Zoom meeting, etc.
No, ma'am, so, there's enough time. I was just writing down the points.
Okay.
Yes.
So if I can explore it further. So if you go technically, no one would say that Indian Penal Code, CRPC, CPC, they are what has it got to do with democracy? It has got to do with democracy because democracy gives you the right of dignity, to live a life of dignity and respect. And therefore, if you do not get the rights which is laid down in the Constitution, then it's not that you are remedyless. You have a remedy through the Constitution. But these days there's a lot of discussion on the democracy, on the fundamental duties also. So we also have to focus that fundamental duties also are equally important, which is not getting highlighted so much. And fundamental duties, that you have to draw a line between rights, like your right might get clashed with your duty also. But then that judge which is there in you will tell you where to stop, where to draw the line. So, the correlation between democratic process and the role of law you would not take long, or it's not a rocket science to understand that what is the connection between the two. But since I think the avid listeners are the students, the young mind, so they must get the clarity of the idea of between the two. Because many students who have opted for political science, or they must have studied in their civics subject also, even in school, they get. But there's a murky idea. So as and when you grow and as and when you mature, you have to get the clarity of thought. You have to be confident of what you understand. Because if you understand, that will be, you know, valuable in all walk of life. That if you understand the subject and with clarity, that will enable you to take an informed decision in whatever you do. So it's a democracy. In another way of expressing is that you can understand that democracy is the dictionary definition of a democracy. I'm reading it out. The democracy is a government by the people, in which the supreme power is vested in the people and exercised directly by them or by their elected agents under a free electoral system. But I have a method of expressing myself. I have always followed that these theoretical precepts and the theoretical lecture that we give, many a times I have a feeling that perhaps it is not seeping into the minds of the listeners. They should be able to comprehend what the speaker is saying. So instead of going to the theoretical part, let that theory be explained in simple words so that you can register what the speaker is saying. So I switched over to the theoretical aspect. I said I'll read it at the last for the benefit. And all these are not, this is what I have said. But when you coin it, when you have to write an answer and make it very presentable, like, you know, but your presentation also has to be there. So if you have to present, then of course, many a times you have to indulge in theory also. So let it be a mix of both. A democratic government implies a democratic state, but a democratic state does not necessarily mean a democratic government. A democratic state means is that a community as a whole possesses sovereign authority and maintains ultimate controlling, even to the extent of a government. In addition to being a form of government and a type of state, democracy is an order of society. A democratic is one in which the spirit of equality and fraternity prevails. Such a society does not necessarily imply a democratic state or a democratic government. And I pause here for a minute. I am reading this from a scholarly article that I read for your, you have to brush up your knowledge also at times. So I compliment this author because there were very many articles on the internet, which I, you know, cursorily went through it, but I found that this was the most, it had a lot of clarity. As I said, I always focus on clarity, and I would compliment the author of this article. I don't know if I can, some scholar Pankaj or something. I can't, you know, scroll and get the name right now. So these were the very beautifully coined words regarding democracy. But we believe the, you know, the execution theory. The theory is there, but you have to make the audience understand what is there. So the democratic process, you would get so many, you know, the theory, but you have to understand what is the connection in between the two. So having said that, I think I would, you know, now conclude, because I'm also looking forward to interacting with the students. I said in the beginning that the beautiful part of these lectures, which I'm now missing during because most of the time, I wouldn't say most, it's invariably now through video online conferences and the online lectures, and that note, the deep connection, touch in between the audience and the speaker, I'm missing this a lot. I'm looking forward to come to your, physically to come to your university and then meet each one of you, because the online cannot be a substitute. Of course, it's a very good substitute on this during this, you know, compelling circumstances, but you know, it cannot take the place of a physical hearing and a physical this thing. So, but something can be compensated by interacting with the question and answer. So I look forward to meeting the students. So many thanks for inviting me. Many thanks for including me. And the topic is, although relatively, I would say it's quite a simple topic, yet, but I always follow simplicity. That's in my psyche. So simple topic, but great relevance and value, which is not theoretical at all, which needs to be understood by each one of us. We're looking forward to many more of them. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you so much, ma'am. Really grateful to you. I think you put the lecture on law and democracy in a democracy in a very simple manner for the students to understand. And you took up many issues, you know, talking about the preamble, that democracy is in the preamble itself. The spirit of democracy is in the preamble. You also talked about fair elections. You also talked about duties. You've talked about fundamental rights. You also talked about everybody. What happens when there is discrimination, they can go to the courts. At the same time, you've also talked about the obligation which is there on the state to see that democratic principles are implemented. I think you've summarized it very well, ma'am. And I'll open the house for question answer session now. Students, you may please ask questions. Okay. There are some questions which I've got, ma'am. Am I audible to you, clear to you?
Yes.
Yeah, the first question is, it is by Vishaka Singh Deshwal. Should there be an independent institution for the appointment and transfer of judges of the higher judiciary to ensure higher transparency? How do we ensure the constitutionality of such an institution? This is from a faculty member, ma'am. Vishaka is our faculty.
Actually, you know, as you all you are aware, there's already a collegium system for appointment of judges. And that was, you know, that was carved out by through a judgment, you must be aware. So initially, what the constitution makers had given to us was a consultation in between the with the executive and the Chief Justice of India, of course, for a state, in the state it is Governor of State, and for the Supreme Court it's not President ultimately gives the warrant of appointment. So you know, the experience which has taught us that we have to be very, very careful about appointing the judges, in the sense that if you because I will tell you the past experience. The past experience was, there was not even a collegium. There was the, as I said, the consultation between the governor, chief justice, and the chief minister. So all three of them. Then the experience showed that at the state level, there were the, after 1950, there was very little interference of the chief minister. Whatever the chief justice recommended was they were, you know, they were acceptable, and the consultation process was almost like a, just a, I won't say formality, but they were just a, taking each organ of the state into confidence. But gradually, all the legal fraternity, of course, because we have been there in the system, we started suffering aberrations in that system also, in the sense there was a lot of, there were very many interferences from one organ. I cannot really be very candid about it. What we say in Hindi, thoda kaha, jada samajhiye. So there was kind of distrust about the choices, and there was a lot of, you know, like putting the foot down that one has to do this, that. That is how, you know, these 11 judges' judgment came in with the Advocate and Record Association, where a collegium system was formed. Now, the question, that coming to the main part of the question is that should there be some new form of method of selection? So, main part is that who should get the authority to choose the judges? Where should it lie? Bluntly put, you know, who is going to bell the cat? So if you could say what is the question, whether she wants the power to be vested in the executive, in the legislature, or the jury, what is the composition you would want to suggest? I could have answered it better. So
She wants to know that should we have an independent institution outside the courts for appointment and transfer of judges of the higher judiciary so that transparency is ensured? And is it possible under the Constitution of India, you know, to have such an institution? Is it possible to have?
Possibility is always there by way of the amendment came, that National Judicial Accountability Bill.
Yes.
But I would suggest that you better have a separate session for this, because the subject is this, and there are sky is the limit kind of a, you know, question and answer session. So I would request that you must focus your questions mainly related to the subject, because in one of the sessions I had to reprimand the anchor, because he went to the extent of organized a webinar, online webinar, and then some judgment had come about contempt of court, and he started asking me questions on so merely because a former judge is there, I'm also now a part of you only. I would also discuss with you what should be the improvement. So it's better, you know, but if you want to form an opinion, you must come out your question with candidates, you know.
Right.
It's very easy to say that should there be an independent institution. First of all, you have to identify who are those who are going to be the members of that institution. So which was struck down, a composition was there. So first of all, but yes, there discussion should be there, you know. We must always strive. Because it's a very difficult question to answer. So tomorrow, if I say it should be I might be quoted that former judges like this. So, and it's a very, very delicate subject too. So, but it should, if the audience is the the professor is very frank. She should tell who should be the, all right, I would welcome that idea. Speaking for myself, of course, I can't speak for the entire fraternity. Speaking for myself, I would welcome the idea. But first of all, who should be, what should be the composition? That is the most tricky question. Like, absolutely. What would be the what would be the composition of that institution?
Institution, right. Huh. Absolutely, ma'am. You're absolutely right. And we need another session for this debate. I agree with you, because I had supervised a PhD on this topic, and it took about 5-6 years, you know, finally for the submission of that PhD. Ma'am, a student wants to know that why is it that India doesn't have, you know, strict like in other countries? I don't know why he's asked this question, because I think what he means is proper implementation, you know. That is what is lacking. I think our laws are very good. Otherwise,
it's just I didn't quite get a feel of the question.
A student is wanting to know, why can't our country have stricter laws for better management of the country, law and order situation?
Oh, I think I get the knack of the question. Perhaps would he welcome the because we are in a democracy, not in an authoritarian rule. And authoritarian rule, if the entire constitution cannot, you know, there was a time when there was a lot of debate about the presidential and the parliamentary form of government. In America, we have presidential form of government. So here, if you have parliamentary form of government, and you are selecting, so stricter laws means the laws are already there, but stricter laws cannot go to the extent of being strict without a fair trial. The fair trial is the ethics of democracy. I did not say much on that, but free and fair trial also is there. But when you question, you see, I would like to express that when we think about those changes, we must put ourselves, like just one individual should put that himself or herself in the situation that if this happens to me, what is the treatment that I would want for myself? Then you can decide it better. Because if you adopt an authoritarian, today A is there, tomorrow B is there, thereafter C is there. So if he's wanting that, you know, stricter means, the question I would appreciate, you know, it should not be vague. You must be a little, there should be clarity in answers. There should be clarity on the questions also. Authoritarian means that if you are trying to hint that there should be no free and fair trial, if something has happened, then put him behind the bars. We are also having some acts like National Security Act also was like that, and there are so many other acts, but they all, you know, experience shows it that we cannot go to the extent. And once we are adopting a democratic process of government, we cannot compromise with the values of the basic structure that we have adopted.
To one more question, ma'am, you must be tired. You know, the student wants to know, in a democratic setup, you know, he wants to also question the reservation policy. He said, can't we do away with the reservation policy? Ma'am, this is also a subject where a lot of time is required. You could just give us, you know, your opinion and share.
You see, actually, all the questions, all the three questions that have been put to me, I think it's the parliamentarians who should be put all these questions.
Yes.
I would just be one among you to express my view. But if you really want to make an impact, then it's the parliament. And there are two viewpoints. Of course, the essential vision was that the the reservation policy should end after a particular period. And in spite of that, if it is getting extended, maybe the experience shows that we have still not reached the stage. But to be very frank about it, it's basically the vote bank which prevails upon the lawmakers. But it would be unfair also to say that that those decisions are taken, because why is it getting a support? There somewhere is there. So reservation, much can be said both ways. And that is how, it is midway. But yes. I would suggest, please don't put these questions to judges. You must put these questions to the parliamentarians. Invite a parliamentarian, Dr. Batra, and ask them to answer these questions. But yeah. Your difficulty would be those answers will go on the party lines.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, I agree with you that it has to be reviewed. The policy needs to be reviewed, because Ambedkar had said that, it should be reviewed after every 10 years when the members of the Constituent Assembly were deliberating on the various articles. Yeah, yeah. And of course, ma'am, you must have done it in political science. Yes.
Actually, I went into execution, no? Democracy I did in as a political science student. Yes. But execution, I was more into execution because I came into law.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. But you have an excellent combination. Excellent combination.
Yeah, yes. But I would share some of my personal, my father was very disappointed in spite of such good percentage, why have you not gone into economics than law?
Yes.
But I had already decided to, I said, no, I want to, because it is very much akin to law, and I'm already knowing all the how the constitution was made, how who fought for these constitutions. So I was a bit adamant in my choice of subject, which always came. If he had been here in person, he's no more, but he would have said, "Humne isko bola tha, tum economics mein jao."
I know. Fathers are all the same. True, true.
Yeah.
Anyway, ma'am.
But I'm feeling because I don't get to see the students at all, or the faces who are putting the questions.
Yes, ma'am. I know.
But there is a mode I will let you know later where you can see the at least the person who is putting the question.
In future, we will see that they are here.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, yes, because it becomes always better. Yes.
Yeah, there's always a next time with better output.
Yes, ma'am. And we are looking forward to your coming here physically as soon as things get better and we all get the confidence that, yes, yeah, the pandemic is over.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Yeah. Ma'am, thank you very much for a very insightful, a very enlightening lecture on the role of law in a democracy. There are many takeaways that I've written down, and there is more clarity. But of course, because of constraint of time, I'm not putting all the questions before you. Come in person, then of course you can meet the students and also, have an interaction with them.
Yeah, but it, I tell you, it came as a surprise to me that I'm the only speaker in this event. So I wish, but hearing the questions, I was, thinking that maybe I had a parliamentarian along with me. I passed on the questions to them. That now is, first of all, you answer, then I will give my judgment on that.
Ma'am, actually, this is a masterclass series specialized by the Northcap University, okay, for the induction program also, an ongoing series. So we are getting all very eminent people to deliver lecture every day for the benefit of the students and the faculty.
Yeah, so, you are doing it with so much of devotion and commitment. I can feel that. I can see that.
Yeah, so because it's always a pleasure to listen to people like you, ma'am. And we will be connected. And thank you so much, ma'am, for being with us. I know it is very difficult for you. You are a very, very busy person. Whenever I tried calling you up, I had to wait for many hours. got some response. And I
it's just a coincidence. Many a times it's a coincidence also.
Yes,
but
yes,
ma'am. During the daytime and I'm fully occupied. But
I know. Yeah. But it's been a pleasure having you with us. And on behalf the management, all the officials of the North Cap University, all the deans and the heads and the faculty members, the students and the staff, I really thank you from my heart for being here with us. And we hope to call you again sometime in the near future. Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you. Wish you all the best. Wish you all a great future in whatever you do, in whatever you are devoted.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you.